grab those tickets. Let's go.
This is the bi-weekly Powerball drawing. There's no secret algorithm churning out the winning numbers in a back room. It's just these numbered balls randomly popping out of a draw machine at Florida Lottery's Tallahassee studio. There are two of these $50,000 gravity pick machines at every drawing. One holds 69 white balls, and the second holds 26 red ones. All 95 of these $100 apiece solid rubber balls are mixed by a drum that has spinning and rotating paddles. The balls must mix for a minimum of 5 seconds after being dropped from their holding tubes before selection is to begin. After that, optical sensors track them as they drop one at a time through the bottom of the drum. And voila, we have the next set of winning numbers. But ever wonder what's happening behind the scenes? Here's a look inside America's multi-billion dollar lottery empire. Chances are, if you're 18 or older, you've probably played the lottery. 95% of the country lives in a lottery state, and roughly half of Americans say they play. That makes it the country's most popular form of gambling by a long shot. And the game doesn't discriminate. You're eligible to play even if you aren't a US citizen. Same goes if you don't live in the state selling the ticket. It's also a huge moneymaker. In 2018 alone, Americans spent just over $80 billion on lottery tickets. Some of that went to players in the form of jackpots touching record highs of $1.6 billion. And another hefty portion of it was funneled back to state governments. In fact, the lottery has long been the government's go-to when it comes to shoring up extra cash. America's lottery history goes back a couple hundred years, and it's actually credited with building the country.
Lotteries were actually part of the revolutionary times in America. George Washington's army was founded by a lottery. Harvard, Yale, and Princeton were founded by a lottery. In those days, you had roads and bridges and schools and even churches who were often founded by lottery dollars raised.
After the Civil War, a powerful Protestant movement pushed to outlaw various vices like obscenity, drinking, and gambling. It worked. By 1878, all states had banned lotteries except Louisiana, which held out until 1895. Though Puerto Rico started up a lottery in 1934, the income tax system largely filled the void across the continental United States until 1964, when the first state-run lottery started up in New Hampshire as a way to augment state coffers. By the 80s, states started to band together to form multi-state lotteries to generate those big cash prizes we've grown accustomed to. And as of 2019, 44 states participate, plus the District of Columbia and the U.S. Virgin Islands. To be clear, the modern-day lottery is an umbrella term that encompasses any type of gambling operated by the state. That includes everything from scratch-offs to draw games. The lotto is the game that almost always offers the biggest jackpot. You're probably familiar with the country's two biggest multi-state lottos, Powerball and Mega Millions. That's what we're going to be focusing on. Both Mega Millions and Powerball started in the 1990s, though Mega Millions went by a different name back then. Mega Millions and Powerball prizes used to hand out jackpots as low as 10 to 12 million bucks. Even though the top prize was handed out more often, the prizes were relatively underwhelming and led to jackpot fatigue. But now, both jackpots automatically reset to 40 million, they're handed out a lot less often, and the top prize can grow to highs of over $1.5 billion. That's garnered a whole lot more attention. And these top prizes are still only a fraction of what they could be. Instant ticket games, also known as scratch-offs, offer immediate results. These games have payouts varying anywhere from 65 to 80%. Mega Millions and Powerball are played the exact same way. Players either choose their own set of numbers or ask for a quick pick ticket where the numbers are randomly selected for them. Both are 50% payout games. That means that when you head to a deli to buy a quick pick ticket for $2, only half of that money goes toward prizes. More on that a little bit later. Both Powerball and Mega Millions are state-run games. Each has a distinct set of member states and their own governing bodies. But in 2010, the two groups struck a deal to sell both tickets in all lottery-friendly states.
We were no longer competing with one another. We were both selling both games. And in terms of total industry lottery sales in the U.S., it's about half and half between the Mega Million states and the muscle states. And obviously, we sell both games into each other's jurisdictions just based on licensing.
That cross-selling pact is part of what's been driving up jackpots. Mega Millions also doubled its ticket price from $1 to $2, which helped. But the biggest change has to do with the odds of winning. Both Powerball and Mega Millions recently rolled out a few big rule changes that move the odds drastically out of your favor, at least when it comes to winning the top prize. In 2015, Powerball increased the number of white balls from 59 to 69, and it reduced the choices for the Powerball from 35 to 26 red balls. What that did was drive down the odds of you winning the jackpot from 1 in 175 million to 1 in 292 million. Mega Millions modified its formula in 2017 with its own set of tweaks to the number choices. The odds of winning that jackpot are now roughly 1 in 302 million. But Mega Millions lead director says that even though it's harder than ever to win, that's actually been great for ticket sales.
It was to make those bigger jackpots happen, to bring in those players who are not regular lottery players. The big jackpots seem to have that kind of effect.
In the U.S., state governments operate all lotteries, giving it a monopoly over the lucrative business. Unlike casinos, there is zero competition from private industry, and a hefty portion of the profits go right to state budgets. Take New York. Former trader and data scientist Max Galka walked CNBC through the path of a New York Lotto dollar.
Of that dollar that's spent, 16 cents goes to pay commissions to the retailer who sold the ticket, which leaves 84 cents remaining that goes to the lottery commission. Of that, 1 cent goes to pay for advertising, another cent goes to pay for the lottery commission's operating expenses. 34 cents goes to the public education system. That leaves 48 cents remaining that is paid out in prizes. Of that, 1 cent goes unclaimed. Another 4 cents goes to pay state income taxes. 10 cents goes to federal income taxes. And in New York City, 2 cents goes to pay for city tax. That leaves 31 cents for the ultimate winner. So of the $1 that was spent to purchase the ticket, 31 cents is paid out in winnings.
This means that the New York Lottery needs to spend 36 cents in order to raise a tax dollar. The IRS, on the other hand, spends less than a cent for every dollar it raises. So using lotteries to generate revenue for state governments is a pretty inefficient way to raise money. If a drawing doesn't materialize in a grand prize winner, Powerball, for example, invests the cash so the pool of money can grow even faster.
It would be financial mismanagement if we didn't invest those funds, at least for the short period of time that we have it. We are talking about a lottery product. We don't know when there will be a grand prize winner. Could be any Wednesday or any Saturday night. Obviously very conservative and extremely short term, just given the nature of our business.
From here, each state decides how to spend its lottery revenue. Oregon uses some of its profits to pay for gambling addiction prevention and treatment programs, and Wisconsin spends its lotto profits on offsetting property taxes. But education is the most popular destination for that cash by a long shot. In New York, Florida, and California, the states that take in the most in terms of ticket sales, all of this lotto cash went to education. However, recent research questions if this is the boon for education that states want it to be.
We took a look at the impact of having an education lottery on education spending in the state and found that after like 7 or 8 years, you were spending less on education if you had an education lottery as opposed to not having an education lottery. Turns out in most cases that the funds actually substitute for general revenue so that it doesn't really do what it claims.
In California, for instance, an investigation from the LAist and KPCC showed that lottery revenues are up by billions since 2010 when lawmakers decided to lose the requirement that 34 cents of every dollar go to education. But that same report found that contributions to education by the lottery were essentially unchanged. The move was designed to instead put more money toward efforts to boost spending on tickets. The report showed that while it worked, as of 2018, the amount of each dollar earmarked for education hovers at around 23 cents. So that's what the states do with their portion of lottery revenue. And then there's the path of the prize money. Let's say you beat the odds and your ticket has all 6 winning numbers. The first thing to know, that top jackpot isn't what you're going to be taking home. The federal government automatically skims 24% off the top. Then, at tax time, Uncle Sam collects the rest. Prize money is treated like income, so the IRS is going to tax you at the top income bracket of 37%. Almost all participating states will also take their own cut, too. State tax percentages vary, with New York among the highest at 8.82%. It's even higher if you're in New York City. The one thing that is in your control is whether you take your prize money in one lump sum or go with the annuity option, which means you get 30 annual payments over the next 29 years. The first is also referred to as the cash value of the prize, and while it's much less than the estimated jackpot, most financial advisors say to always go with that option. That way, you can invest the bulk sum and make up the difference over time. And it's not just the jackpot winner who can take home cash. Both games offer a tapered prize payout system depending upon how many correct numbers you choose. The payouts at each level are fixed no matter how big the jackpot is. This seems like a win-win. Consumers get to play a fun game with the chance of winning life-changing money, and states get an easy source of revenue. But the lottery system has a few notable problems. First, critics question the ethics of lottery advertising. There are multiple daily triggers to buy lotto tickets pretty much everywhere you go, especially in big cities like New York. This onslaught of advertising rarely comes with any sort of disclaimer about the low odds of winning. That's because states don't have to. They're exempt from the Federal Trade Commission's Truth in Advertising laws. These laws prevent businesses from advertising to consumers with misleading claims about their products' benefits or effects. But state governments are allowed to self-regulate. While some states have laws capping how much money can be spent on advertising, skeptics argue states aren't doing enough to protect the consumer, which leads to the next criticism, that lotteries are a regressive tax. See, each lottery ticket is $2 anywhere you go. But $2 means a lot more to, say, someone making $25,000 per year than someone making three times that. Both people have equal access to the tickets, but the prices don't affect them equally.
Assume your state is going to spend $100 on education, and now the lottery is going to come along and be in an additional $10. Is your state saying, well, we were going to spend $100 and now we're going to spend $110 because we got this new money on education? Or is your state going to be say, well, we were still going to spend $100 on education, these $10 are now going to be a part of it, so now we can slide out $10, and maybe we give that $10 as a tax cut, and possibly a tax cut to high-income people? If you're doing the latter, then you're not adding anything. You're just simply shifting the burden of who's paying your taxes and who's paying for your revenue, and you're putting that burden higher on lower income people.
But state advertising techniques have long targeted the poor anyway. Going back to the late 90s, one study from the National Gambling Impact Study Commission showed that the Ohio Super Lotto game appeared to explicitly target lower income groups by intentionally timing lottery promotions to coincide with the receipt of government benefits, payroll, and Social Security payments. Also in the 90s, the Illinois Lottery put up a billboard in a Chicago ghetto that read, "This could be your ticket out." More recently, the California Lottery was soliciting help from an agency with its African American Consumer Market Advertising Services. Or there's Iowa Lottery's TV ad campaign, "It's Your Dream, Anything Can Happen," which employs magical thinking, a common type of lottery advertisement.
It's impossible to not make it a regressive tax. Low-income people are always going to spend a higher share of their income on lotteries than higher-income people.
But it's not quite as clear-cut as that. A 2016 nationwide Gallup survey actually found that Americans whose annual household income is less than $36,000 per year were substantially less likely than higher income Americans to say they have purchased a state lottery ticket within the last year. And respondents with a college education were actually more likely to buy a ticket than those who finished only high school. Take Massachusetts, a state with a lot of educated and wealthy people with a median income of $74,000. Residents there spend the most on lotto tickets, $741 per year per resident in 2017. Finally, states get to run lotteries as a monopoly. Competition from private entities isn't allowed. Without private competitors, there's little incentive to lower prices, raise prizes, or sweeten the odds for the gambler.
It's been a struggle for states to keep their lotteries generating as much revenue as they want. Nobody likes competition.
William Thompson's 2001 book on gambling looks at states where other types of gambling, like that at casinos or the Kentucky Derby, are legal. Thompson finds that returns to the bettor are often much higher than post-tax lottery wins. For example, as of 2018, 25 states have laws requiring minimum payouts on casino games. The average requirement is about 81%. In 2018, the Supreme Court added another gambling opportunity by striking down a law that prohibits sports betting.
Gambling on sports really poses some issues for a lot of states in terms of whether they can capture that revenue. States with lotteries probably have to be concerned that they're going to stop getting revenue through the lotteries.
Unlike lotteries, sports gambling is administered by a crowded field of private companies. 1 year out from the Supreme Court decision, the Urban Institute released a report showing that the overall benefit to state budgets has so far been mixed. It's unclear yet what effect this will have on lottery revenue, if any. States will have to hope the odds are in their favor.